Gabriel Conroy. By Bret Harte. Podcast 2 of 16. Book 1. On the Threshold. Chapter 4. Nature shows them the way. It was a spur of the long grave-like ridge that lay to the north of the cannon. Up its gaunt white flank two figures had been slowly crawling since noon, until at sunset they at last stood upon its outer verge outlined against the sky, Philip and Grace. For all the fatigues of the journey, the want of nourishing food and the haunting shadow of the suffering she had left, the face of Grace, flushed with the dying sun, was very pretty. The boy's dress she had borrowed was ill-fitting, and made her exquisite little figure still more diminutive, but it could not entirely hide its graceful curves. Here in this rosy light the swooning fringes of her dark eyes were no longer hidden, the perfect oval of her face, even the few freckles on her short upper lip, were visible to Philip. Partly as a physical support, partly to reassure her, he put his arm tenderly around her waist. Then he kissed her. It is possible that this last act was purely gratuitous. Howbeit, Grace first asked, with the characteristic prudence of her sex, the question she had already asked many days before that day, "Do you love me, Philip?" And Philip, with the ready frankness of our sex on such occasions, had invariably replied, "I do." Nevertheless, the young man was preoccupied, anxious, and hungry. It was the fourth day since they had left the hut. On the second day they had found some pine cones with the nuts still intact and fresh beneath the snow, and later a squirrel's hoard. On the third day Philip had killed the proprietor and eaten him. The same evening Philip had espied a duck winging his way up the cannon. Philip, strong in the belief that some inland lake was the immediate object of its flight, had first marked its course, and then brought it down with a long shot. Then, having altered their course in accordance with its suggestion, they ate their guide next morning for breakfast. Philip was also disappointed. The summit of the spur so laboriously attained only showed him the same endless succession of white snow billows stretching rigidly to the horizon's edge. There was no break, no glimpse of watercourse or lake. There was nothing to indicate whence the bird had come or the probable point it was endeavoring to reach. He was beginning to consider the feasibility of again changing their course, when an unlooked-for accident took that volition from his hands. Grace had ventured out to the extreme limit of the rocky cliff, and with straining eyes was trying to peer beyond the snow fields, when the treacherous ledge on which she was standing began to give way. In an instant Philip was at her side and had caught her hand, but at the same moment a large rock of the ledge dropped from beneath her feet, and left her with no support but his grasp. The sudden shock loosened also the insecure granite on which Philip stood. Before he could gain secure foothold it also trembled, tottered, slipped, and then fell, carrying Philip and Grace with it. Luckily this immense mass of stone and ice got fairly away before them, and plowed down the steep bank of the cliff, breaking off the projecting rocks and protuberances, and cutting a clean, though almost perpendicular, path down the mountainside. Even in falling Philip had presence of mind enough to forbear clutching at the crumbling ledge, and so precipitating the rock that might crush them. Before he lost his senses he remembered tightening his grip of Grace's arm, and drawing her face and head forward to his breast, and even in his unconsciousness it seemed that he instinctively guided her into the smooth passage or chute made by the plunging rock below them, and even then he was half conscious of dashing into sudden material darkness and out again into light, and of the crashing and crackling of branches around him, and even the brushing of the stiff pine needles against his face and limbs. Then he felt himself stopped, and then only, everything whirled confusedly by him, and his brain seemed to partake of the motion, and then the relief of utter blankness and oblivion. When he regained his senses, it was with a burning heat in his throat, and the sensation of strangling. When he opened his eyes he saw Grace bending over him, pale and anxious, and chafing his hands and temples with snow. There was a spot of blood upon her round cheek. "You are hurt, Grace," were the first words that Philip gasped. "No, dear, brave Philip, but only so thankful and happy for your escape." Yet, at the same moment the color faded from her cheek, and even the sun-kissed line of her upper lip grew bloodless, as she leaned back against a tree. But Philip did not see her. His eyes were rapidly taking in his strange surroundings. He was lying among the broken fragments of pine branches and the debris of the cliff above. In his ears was the sound of hurrying water, and before him, scarce 100 feet, a rushing river. He looked up, the red glow of sunset was streaming through the broken limbs and shattered branches of the snow-thatched roof that he had broken through in his descent. Here and there along the river the same light was penetrating the interstices and openings of this strange vault that arched above this sunless stream. He knew now whence the duck had flown. He knew now why he had not seen the watercourse before. He knew now where the birds and beasts had betaken themselves, why the woods and cannons were trackless. Here was at last the open road. He staggered to his feet with a cry of delight. "Grace, we are saved." Grace looked at him with eyes that perhaps spoke more eloquently of joy at his recovery than of comprehension of his delight. "Look, Grace, this is nature's own road, only a lane, perhaps but a clue to our way out of this wilderness. As we descend the stream it will open into a broader valley." "I know it," she said, simply. Philip looked at her inquiringly. "When I dragged you out of the way of the falling rocks and snow above, I had a glimpse of the valley you speak of. I saw it from there." She pointed to a ledge of rock above the opening where the great stone that had fallen had lodged. "When you dragged me, my child." Grace smiled faintly. "You don't know how strong I am," she said, and then proved it by fainting dead away. Philip started to his feet and ran to her side. Then he felt for the precious flask that he had preserved so sacredly through all their hardships, but it was gone. He glanced around him, it was lying on the snow, empty. For the first time in their weary pilgrimage Philip uttered a groan. At the sound Grace opened her sweet eyes. She saw her lover with the empty flask in his hand, and smiled faintly. "I poured it all down your throat, dear," she said. "You look so faint I thought you were dying, forgive me. But I was only stunned, and you, Grace, you—" "I am better now," she said, as she strove to rise. But she uttered a weak little cry and fell back again. Philip did not hear her. He was already climbing the ledge she had spoken of. When he returned his face was joyous. "I see it, Grace, it is only a few miles away. It is still light, and we shall camp there tonight." "I am afraid not, dear Philip," said Grace, doubtfully. "Why not?" asked Philip, a little impatiently. "Because I think my leg is broken, Grace." But she had fainted. Chapter 5. Out of the woods into the shadow. Happily Grace was wrong. Her ankle was severely sprained, and she could not stand. Philip tore up his shirt, and, with bandages dipped in snow water, wrapped up the swollen limb. Then he knocked over a quail in the bushes and another duck, and clearing away the brush for a camping spot, built a fire, and tempted the young girl with a hot supper. The peril of starvation passed, their greatest danger was over a few days longer of enforced rest, and inactivity was the worst to be feared. The air had grown singularly milder with the last few hours. At midnight a damp breeze stirred the pine needles above their heads, and an ominous muffled beating was heard upon the snow-packed vault. It was rain. "It is the reveille of spring," whispered Philip. But Grace was in no mood for poetry, even a lover's. She let her head drop upon his shoulder, and then said, "You must go on, dear, and leave me here." "Grace." "Yes, Philip. I can live till you come back. I fear no danger now. I am so much better off than they are." A few tears dropped on his hand. Philip winced. Perhaps it was his conscience, perhaps there was something in the girl's tone, perhaps because she had once before spoken in the same way, but it jarred upon a certain quality in his nature which he was pleased to call his common sense. Philip really believed himself a high-souled, thoughtless, ardent, impetuous temperament, saved only from destruction by the occasional dominance of this quality. For a moment he did not speak. He thought how, at the risk of his own safety, he had snatched this girl from terrible death, he thought how he had guarded her through their perilous journey, taking all the burdens upon himself, he thought how happy he had made her, how she had even admitted her happiness to him, he thought of her present helplessness, and how willing he was to delay the journey on her account, he dwelt even upon a certain mysterious, ill-defined but blissful future with him to which he was taking her, and yet, here, at the moment of their possible deliverance, she was fretting about two dying people, who, without miraculous interference, would be dead before she could reach them. It was part of Philip's equitable self-examination, a fact of which he was very proud, that he always put himself in the position of the person with whom he differed, and imagined how he would act under the like circumstances. Perhaps it is hardly necessary to say that Philip always found that his conduct under those conditions would be totally different. In the present instance, putting himself in Grace's position, he felt that he would have abandoned all and everything for a love and future like hers. That she did not was evidence of a moral deficiency or a blood taint. Logic of this kind is easy and irrefutable. It has been known to obtain even beyond the Sierras, and with people who were not physically exhausted. After a pause he said to Grace, in a changed voice, "Let us talk plainly for a few moments, Grace, and understand each other before we go forward or backward. It is 5 days since we left the hut. Were we even certain of finding our wandering way back again, we could not reach them before another 5 days had elapsed. By that time all will be over. They have either been saved or are beyond the reach of help." This sounds harsh, Grace, but it is no harsher than the fact. Had we stayed, we would, without helping them, have only shared their fate. I might have been in your brother's place, you in your sister's. It is our fortune, not our fault, that we are not dying with them. It has been willed that you and I should be saved. It might have been willed that we should have perished in our attempts to succor them, and that relief which came to them would have never reached us. Grace was no logician, and could not help thinking that if Philip had said this before, she would not have left the hut. But the masculine reader will, I trust, at once detect the irrelevance of the feminine suggestion, and observe that it did not refute Philip's argument. She looked at him with a half-frightened air. Perhaps it was the tears that dimmed her eyes, but his few words seemed to have removed him to a great distance, and for the first time a strange sense of loneliness came over her. She longed to reach her yearning arms to him again, but with this feeling came a sense of shame that she had not felt before. Philip noticed her hesitation, and half interpreted it. He let her passive head fall. "Perhaps we had better wait until we are ourselves out of danger before we talk of helping others," he said with something of his old bitterness. "This accident may keep us here some days, and we know not as yet where we are. Go to sleep now," he said more kindly, "and in the morning we will see what can be done." Grace sobbed herself to sleep. Poor, poor Grace. She had been looking for this opportunity of speaking about herself, about their future. This was to have been the beginning of her confidence about Dr. Devarge's secret. She would have told him frankly all the doctor had said, even his suspicions of Philip himself. And then Philip would have been sure to have told her his plans, and they would have gone back with help, and Philip would have been a hero whom Gabriel would have instantly recognized as the proper husband for Grace, and they would have all been very happy. And now they were all dead, and had died, perhaps, cursing her, and Philip had not kissed her goodnight, and was sitting gloomily under a tree. The dim light of a leaden morning broke through the snow vault above their heads. It was raining heavily, the river had risen, and was still rising. It was filled with drift and branches, and snow, and ice, the waste and wear of many a mile. Occasionally a large uprooted tree with a gaunt forked root like a mast sailed by. Suddenly Philip, who had been sitting with his chin upon his hands, rose with a shout. Grace looked up languidly. He pointed to a tree that, floating by, had struck the bank where they sat, and then drifted broadside against it, where for a moment it lay motionless. "Grace," he said, with his old spirits, "nature has taken us in hand herself. If we are to be saved, it is by her methods. She brought us here to the water's edge, and now she sends a boat to take us off again. Come. Before Grace could reply, Philip had lifted her gaily in his arms, and deposited her between two upright roots of the tree. Then he placed beside her his rifle and provisions, and leaping himself on the bow of this strange craft, shoved it off with a broken branch that he had found. For a moment it still clung to the bank, and then suddenly catching the impulse of the current, darted away like a living creature. The river was very narrow and rapid where they had embarked, and for a few moments it took all of Philip's energy and undivided attention to keep the tree in the center of the current. Grace sat silent, admiring her lover, alert, forceful, and glowing with excitement. Presently Philip called to her. Do you see that log? We are near a settlement. A freshly hewn log of pine was floating in the current beside them. A ray of hope shot through Grace's sad fancies, if they were so near help, might not it have already reached the sufferers? But she forbore to speak to Philip again upon that subject, and in his new occupation he seemed to have forgotten her. It was with a little thrill of joy that at last she saw him turn, and balancing himself with his bow upon their crank craft, walk down slowly toward her. When he reached her side he sat down, and, taking her hand in his, for the first time since the previous night, he said gently, Grace, my child, I have something to tell you. Grace's little heart throbbed quickly, for a moment she did not dare to lift her long lashes toward his. Without noticing her embarrassment he went on. In a few hours we shall be no longer in the wilderness, but in the world again in a settlement perhaps, among men and perhaps women. Strangers certainly not the relatives you have known, and who know you not the people with whom we have been familiar for so many weeks and days but people who know nothing of us, or our sufferings. Grace looked at him, but did not speak. You understand, Grace, that, not knowing this, they might put their own construction upon our flight. To speak plainly, my child, you are a young woman, and I am a young man. Your beauty, dear Grace, offers an explanation of our companionship that the world will accept more readily than any other, and the truth to many would seem scarcely as natural. For this reason it must not be told. I will go back alone with relief, and leave you here in some safe hands until I return. But I leave you here not as Grace Conroy, you shall take my own name. A hot flush mounted to Grace's throat and cheek, and for an instant, with parted lips, she hung breathless upon his next word. He continued quietly. You shall be my sister Grace Ashley. The blood fell from her cheek, her eyelids dropped, and she buried her face in her hands. Philip waited patiently for her reply. When she lifted her face again, it was quiet and calm. There was even a slight flush of proud color in her cheek as she met his gaze, and with the faintest curl of her upper lip said, You are right. At the same moment there was a sudden breaking of light and warmth and sunshine over their heads, the tree swiftly swung round a sharp curve in the river, and then drifted slowly into a broad, overflowed valley, sparkling with the emerald of gently sloping hillsides, and dazzling with the glow of the noonday sun. And beyond, from a cluster of willows scarcely a mile away, the smoke of a cabin chimney curled in the still air. Chapter 6. Footprints. For 2 weeks an unclouded sun rose and set on the rigid outlines of Monument Point. For 2 weeks there had been no apparent change in the ghastly whiteness of the snow-flanked rocks, in the white billows that rose rank on rank beyond, in the death-like stillness that reigned above and below. It was the first day of April, there was the mildness of early spring in the air that blew over this gaunt waste, and yet awoke no sound or motion. And yet a nearer approach showed that a slow insidious change had been taking place. The white flanks of the mountain were more hollow, the snow had shrunk visibly away in places, leaving the gray rocks naked and protuberant, the rigid outlines were there, but less full and rounded, the skeleton was beginning to show through the wasting flesh, there were great patches of snow that had sloughed away, leaving the gleaming granite bare below. It was the last change of the Hippocratic face that nature turned toward the spectator. And yet this change had been noiseless, the solitude unbroken. And then one day there suddenly drifted across the death-like valley the chime of jingling spurs and the sound of human voices. Down the long defile a cavalcade of mounted men and pack mules made their way, plunging through drifts and clattering over rocks. The unwonted sound awoke the long slumbering echoes of the mountain, brought down small avalanches from cliff and tree, and at last brought from some cavern of the rocks to the surface of the snow a figure so wild, haggard, disheveled, and monstrous, that it was scarcely human. It crawled upon the snow, dodging behind rocks with the timidity of a frightened animal, and at last, squatting behind a tree, awaited in ambush the approach of the party. Two men rode ahead, one grave, preoccupied, and reticent. The other alert, active, and voluble. At last the reticent man spoke, but slowly, and as if recalling a memory rather than recording a present impression. "They cannot be far away from us now. It was in some such spot that I first saw them. The place is familiar." "Heaven send that it may be," said the other hastily, "for to tell you the truth, I doubt if we will be able to keep the men together a day longer in this crazy quest, unless we discover something." "It was here," continued the other dreamily, not heeding his companion, "that I saw the figures of a man and woman. If there is not a cairn of stone somewhere about this spot, I shall believe my dream false, and confess myself an old fool." "Well, as I said before," rejoined the other, laughing, "anything, a scrap of paper, an old blanket, or a broken wagon tongue will do." Columbus helped his course and kept up his crew on a fragment of seaweed. "But what are the men looking at? Great God! There is something moving by yonder rock." By one common superstitious instinct the whole party had crowded together. Those who, a few moments before, had been loudest in their skepticism, held their breath with awe, and trembled with excitement as the shambling figure that had watched them enter the cannon rose from its lair, and taking upon itself a human semblance, with uncouth gestures and a strange hoarse cry made towards them. It was Dumphy. The leader was the first to recover himself. He advanced from the rest and met Dumphy halfway. "Who are you?"
"A man."
"What's the matter?"
"Starving."
"Where are the others?" Dumphy cast a suspicious glance at him and said.
"Who?"
"The others." "You are not alone?"
"Yes, I am."
"How did you get here?"
"What's that to you?"
"I'm here and starving. Gimme something to eat and drink." He sank exhaustedly on all fours again. There was a murmur of sympathy from the men. "Give him something. Don't you see he can't stand much less talk? Where's the doctor?" And then the younger of the leaders thus adjured, "Leave him to me, he wants my help just now more than yours." He poured some brandy down his throat. Dumphy gasped, and then staggered to his feet. "What did you say your name was?" asked the young surgeon kindly.
"Jackson," said Dumphy, with a defiantly blank look.
"Where from?"
"Missouri."
"How did you get here?"
"Strayed from my party."
"And they are?"
"Gone on."
"Gimme something to eat?"
"Take him back to camp and hand him over to Sanchez. He'll know what to do," said the surgeon to one of the men.
"Well, Blunt," he continued, addressing the leader, "you're saved, but your 9 men in Buckram have dwindled down to 1, and not a very creditable specimen at that," he said, as his eyes followed the retreating Dumphy.
"I wish it were all, Doctor," said Blunt simply. "I would be willing to go back now, but something tells me we have only begun. This one makes everything else possible."
"What have you there?" One of the men was approaching, holding a slip of paper with ragged edges, as if torn from some position where it had been nailed.
"A notice from a tree."
"Me no sabe," said the ex-vaquero.
"Nor I," said Blunt, looking at it, "it seems to be in German."
"Call Glar." A tall Swiss came forward. Blunt handed him the paper. The man examined it. "It is a direction to find property, important and valuable property, buried."
"Where?"
"Under a cairn of stones." The surgeon and Blunt exchanged glances.
"Lead us there," said Blunt. It was a muffled, monotonous tramp of about an hour. At the end of that time they reached a spur of the mountain around which the cannon turned abruptly. Blunt uttered a cry. Before them was a ruin, a rude heap of stones originally symmetrical and elevated, but now thrown down and dismantled. The snow and earth were torn up around and beneath it. On the snow lay some scattered papers, a portfolio of drawings of birds and flowers, a glass case of insects broken and demolished, and the scattered feathers of a few stuffed birds. At a little distance lay what seemed to be a heap of ragged clothing. At the sight of it, the nearest horseman uttered a shout and leaped to the ground. It was Mrs. Brackett, dead. Chapter 7. In which the footprints begin to fade. She had been dead about a week. The features and clothing were scarcely recognizable, the limbs were drawn up convulsively. The young surgeon bent over her attentively. "Starved to death?" said Blunt interrogatively. The surgeon did not reply, but rose and examined the scattered specimens. One of them he picked up and placed first to his nose and then to his lips. After a pause he replied quietly, "No. Poisoned." The men fell back from the body. "Accidentally, I think," continued the surgeon coolly, "the poor creature has been driven by starvation to attack the specimens. They have been covered with a strong solution of arsenic to preserve them from the ravages of insects, and this starving woman has been the first to fall a victim to the collector's caution." There was a general movement of horror and indignation among the men. "Just to keep dem birds," said the irate Swiss. "Killing women to save his cussed game," said another. The surgeon smiled. It was an inauspicious moment for Dr. Daveridge's to have introduced himself in person. "If this enthusiastic naturalist is still living, I hope he'll keep away from the men for some hours," said the surgeon to Blunt, privately. "Who is he?" asked the other. "A foreigner, a savant of some note, I should say, in his own country." "I think I have heard the name before, Daveridge's," replied the surgeon, looking over some papers that he had picked up. "He speaks of some surprising discoveries he has made, and evidently valued his collection very highly." "Are they worth recollecting and preserving?" asked Blunt. "Not now," said the surgeon. "Every moment is precious. Humanity first, science afterward," he added lightly, and they rode on. And so the papers and collections preserved with such care, the evidence of many months of patient study, privation, and hardship, the records of triumph and discovery were left lying upon the snow. The wind came down the flanks of the mountain and tossed them hither and thither as if in scorn, and the sun, already fervid, heating the metallic surfaces of the box and portfolio, sank them deeper in the snow, as if to bury them from the sight forever. By skirting the edge of the valley where the snow had fallen away from the mountainside, they reached in a few hours the blazed tree at the entrance of the fateful cannon. The placard was still there, but the wooden hand that once pointed in the direction of the buried huts had, through some mischance of wind or weather, dropped slightly, and was ominously pointing to the snow below. This was still so deep in drifts that the party were obliged to leave their horses and enter the cannon afoot. Almost unconsciously, this was done in perfect silence, walking in single file, occasionally climbing up the sides of the cannon where the rocks offered a better foothold than the damp snow, until they reached a wooden chimney and part of a roof that now reared itself above the snow. Here they paused and looked at each other. The leader approached the chimney, and leaning over it called within. There was no response. Presently, however, the cannon took up the shout and repeated it, and then there was a silence broken only by the falling of an icicle from a rock, or a snow slide from the hill above. Then all was quiet again, until Blunt, after a moment's hesitation, walked around to the opening and descended into the hut. He had scarcely disappeared, as it seemed, before he returned, looking very white and grave, and beckoned to the surgeon. He instantly followed. After a little, the rest of the party, one after another, went down. They stayed some time, and then came slowly to the surface bearing three dead bodies. They returned again quickly, and then brought up the disinterred members of a fourth. This done, they looked at each other in silence. There should be another cabin here, said Blunt after a pause. Here it is, said one of the men, pointing to the chimney of the second hut. There was no preliminary hello, or hesitation now. The worst was known. They all passed rapidly to the opening, and disappeared within. When they returned to the surface, they huddled together a whispering but excited group. They were so much preoccupied that they did not see that their party was suddenly increased by the presence of a stranger. Chapter 8. The footprints grow fainter. It was Philip Ashley. Philip Ashley faded, travel-worn, hollow-eyed, but nervously energetic and eager. Philip, who 4 days before had left Grace the guest of a hospitable trapper's half-breed family in the California Valley. Philip gloomy, discontented, hateful of the quest he had undertaken, but still fulfilling his promise to Grace and the savage dictates of his own conscience. It was Philip Ashley, who now standing beside the hut, turned half cynically, half indifferently toward the party. The surgeon was first to discover him. He darted forward with a cry of recognition, poinsett. Arthur, what are you doing here? Ashley's face flushed crimson at the sight of the stranger. Hush, he said almost involuntarily. He glanced rapidly around the group, and then in some embarrassment replied with awkward literalness, I left my horse with the others at the entrance of the cannon. I see, said the surgeon briskly, you have come with relief like ourselves, but you are too late, too late. Too late, echoed Ashley. Yes, they are all dead or gone. A singular expression crossed Ashley's face. It was unnoticed by the surgeon, who was whispering to Blunt. Presently he came forward. Captain Blunt, this is Lieutenant Poinsett of the 5th Infantry, an old messmate mine, whom I have not met before for 2 years. He is here, like ourselves, on an errand of mercy. It is like him. The unmistakable air of high breeding and intelligence which distinguished Philip always, and the cordial endorsement of the young surgeon, prepossessed the party instantly in his favor. With that recognition, something of his singular embarrassment dropped away. Who are those people? He ventured at last to say. Their names are on this paper, which we found nailed to a tree. Of course, with no survivor present, we are unable to identify them all. The hut occupied by Dr. Daveridge's, whose body, buried in the snow, we have identified by his clothing, and the young girl Grace Conroy and her child sister, are the only ones we are positive about. Philip looked at the doctor. How have you identified the young girl? By her clothing, which was marked. Philip remembered that Grace had changed her clothes for the suit of a younger brother who was dead. Only by that, he asked. No. Dr. Daveridge's in his papers gives the names of the occupants of the hut. We have accounted for all but her brother, and a fellow by the name of Ashley. How do you account for them? Asked Philip with a dark face. Ran away. What can you expect from that class of people? Said the surgeon with a contemptuous shrug. What class? Asked Philip almost savagely. My dear boy, said the surgeon, you know them as well as I didn't they always pass the fort where we were stationed? Didn't they beg what they could, and steal what they otherwise couldn't get, and then report to Washington the incompetency of the military? Weren't they always getting up rows with the Indians and then sneaking away to let us settle the bill? Don't you remember them, the men gaunt, sickly, vulgar, low-toned, the women dirty, snuffy, prematurely old, and prematurely prolific? Philip tried to combat this picture with his recollection of Grace's youthful features, but somehow failed. Within the last half hour his instinctive fastidiousness had increased 100-fold. He looked at the doctor, and said yes. Of course, said the surgeon. It was the old lot. What could you expect? People who could be strong only in proportion to their physical strength, and losing everything with the loss of that? There have been selfishness, cruelty, God knows, perhaps murder done here. Yes, yes, said Philip, hastily, but you were speaking of this girl, Grace Conroy, what do you know of her? Nothing, except that she was found lying there dead with her name on her clothes and her sister's blanket in her arms, as if the wretches had stolen the dying child from the dead girl's arms. But you, Arthur, how chanced you to be here in this vicinity? Are you stationed here?
No, I have resigned from the army.
Good, and you are here.
Alone.
Come, we will talk this over as we return. You will help me make out my report. This, you know, is an official inquiry, based upon the alleged clairvoyant quality of our friend Blunt. I must say we have established that fact, if we have been able to do nothing more. The surgeon then lightly sketched an account of the expedition, from its inception in a dream of Blunt, who was distinctly impressed with the fact that a number of emigrants were perishing from hunger in the Sierras, to his meeting with Philip, with such deftness of cynical humor and playful satire qualities that had lightened the weariness of the mess table of Fort Bobadil that the young men were both presently laughing. Two or three of the party who had been engaged in laying out the unburied bodies, and talking in whispers, hearing these fine gentlemen make light of the calamity in well-chosen epithets, were somewhat ashamed of their own awe, and less elegantly, and I fear less grammatically, began to be jocose too. Whereat the fastidious Philip frowned, the surgeon laughed, and the two friends returned to the entrance of the cannon, and thence rode out of the valley together. Philip's reticence regarding his own immediate past was too characteristic to excite any suspicion or surprise in the mind of his friend. In truth, the doctor was too well pleased with his presence, and the undoubted support which he should have in Philip's sympathetic tastes and congenial habits, to think of much else. He was proud of his friend, proud of the impression he had made among the rude unlettered men with whom he was forced by the conditions of frontier democracy to associate on terms of equality. And Philip, though young, was accustomed to have his friends proud of him. Indeed, he always felt some complacency with himself that he seldom took advantage of this fact. Satisfied that he might have confided to the doctor the truth of his connection with the ill-fated party and his flight with Grace, and that the doctor would probably have regarded him as a hero, he felt less compunction at his suppression of the fact. Their way lay by Monument Point and the dismantled cairn. Philip had already passed it on his way to the cannon, and had felt a thankfulness for the unexpected tragedy that had, as he believed, conscientiously relieved him of a duty to the departed naturalist, yet he could not forego a question. "Is there anything among these papers and collections worth our preserving?" he asked the surgeon. The doctor, who had not for many months had an opportunity to air his general skepticism, was nothing if not derogatory.
"No," he answered, shortly. "If there were any way that we might restore them to the living Dr. Daveridge's, they might minister to his vanity, and please the poor fellow. I see nothing in them that should make them worthy to survive him." The tone was so like Dr. Daveridge's own manner, as Philip remembered it, that he smiled grimly and felt relieved. When they reached the spot, nature seemed to have already taken the same cynical view. The metallic case was already deeply sunken in the snow, the wind had scattered the papers far and wide, and even the cairn itself had tumbled into a shapeless, meaningless ruin. Chapter 9. In which the footprints are lost forever. A fervid May sun had been baking the adobe walls of the Presidio of San Ramon, firing the red tiles, scorching the black courtyard, and driving the mules and vaqueros of a train that had just arrived into the shade of the long galleries of the quadrangle, when the commandante, who was taking his noonday siesta in a low, studded chamber beside the guard room, was gently awakened by his secretary. For 30 years the noonday slumbers of the commander had never been broken. His first thought was the heathen, his first impulse to reach for his trusty Toledo. But, as it so happened, the cook had borrowed it that morning to rake tortillas from the Presidio oven, and Don Juan Salvatierra contented himself with sternly demanding the reason for this unwanted intrusion. "A señorita, an American, desires an immediate audience." Don Juan removed the black silk handkerchief which he had tied round his grizzled brows, and sat up. Before he could assume a more formal attitude, the door was timidly opened, and a young girl entered. For all the disfigurement of scant, coarse, ill-fitting clothing, or the hollowness of her sweet eyes, and even the tears that dimmed their long lashes, For all the sorrow that had pinched her young cheek and straightened the corners of her childlike mouth, she was still so fair, so frank, so youthful, so innocent and helpless, that the commandante stood erect, and then bent forward in a salutation that almost swept the floor. Apparently the prepossession was mutual. The young girl took a quick survey of the gaunt but gentlemanlike figure before her, cast a rapid glance at the serious but kindly eyes that shone above the commander's iron-gray mustachios, dropped her hesitating, timid manner, and, with an impulsive gesture and a little cry, ran forward and fell upon her knees at his feet. The commander would have raised her gently, but she restrained his hand. "No, no, listen. I am only a poor, poor girl, without friends or home. A month ago, I left my family starving in the mountains, and came away to get them help. My brother came with me. God was good to us, Señor, and after a weary tramp of many days we found a trapper's hut and food and shelter. Philip, my brother, went back alone to succour them. He has not returned. Oh, sir, he may be dead, they all may be dead, God only knows. It is 3 weeks ago since he left me, 3 weeks. It is a long time to be alone, Señor, a stranger in a strange land. The trapper was kind, and sent me here to you for assistance. You will help me? I know you will. You will find them, my friends, my little sister, my brother." The commander waited until she had finished, and then gently lifted her to a seat by his side. Then he turned to his secretary, who, with a few hurried words in Spanish, answered the mute inquiry of the commander's eyes. The young girl felt a thrill of disappointment as she saw that her personal appeal had been lost and unintelligible. It was with a slight touch of defiance that was new to her nature that she turned to the secretary, who advanced as interpreter. "You are an American?" "Yes," said the girl, curtly, who had taken one of the strange, swift, instinctive dislikes of her sex to the man. "How many years?" 15. The commander, almost unconsciously, laid his brown hand on her clustering curls. "Name?" She hesitated and looked at the commander. "Grace," she said. Then she hesitated, and, with a defiant glance at the secretary, added, "Grace Ashley. Give to me the names of some of your company, Mees Grace Ashley." Grace hesitated. "Philip Ashley, Gabriel Conroy, Peter Dumphy, Mrs. Jane Dumphy," she said at last. The secretary opened a desk, took out a printed document, unfolded it, and glanced over its contents. Presently he handed it to the commander with the comment, "Bueno." The commander said "Bueno" also, and glanced kindly and reassuringly at Grace. "An expedition from the Upper Presidio has found traces of a party of Americans in the Sierra," said the secretary monotonously. "There are names like these." "It is the same, it is our party," said Grace, joyously. "You say so," said the secretary, cautiously. "Yes," said Grace, defiantly. The secretary glanced at the paper again, and then said, looking at Grace intently, "There is no name of Mees Grace Ashley." The hot blood suddenly dyed the cheek of Grace and her eyelids dropped. She raised her eyes imploringly to the commander. If she could have reached him directly, she would have thrown herself at his feet and confessed her innocent deceit, but she shrank from a confidence that first filtered through the consciousness of the secretary. So she began to fence feebly with the issue. "It is a mistake," she said. "But the name of Philip, my brother, is there." "The name of Philip Ashley is here," said the secretary, grimly. "And he is alive and safe," cried Grace, forgetting in her relief and joy her previous shame and mortification. "He is not found," said the secretary. "Not found," said Grace, with widely opened eyes. "He is not there." "No, of course," said Grace, with a nervous hysterical laugh, "he was with me, but he came back, he returned. On the 30th of April there is no record of the finding of Philip Ashley." Grace groaned and clasped her hands. In her greater anxiety now, All lesser fears were forgotten. She turned and threw herself before the commander.
Oh, forgive me, Senor, but I swear to you I meant no harm.
Philip is not my brother, but a friend, so kind, so good. He asked me to take his name, poor boy, God knows if he will ever claim it again, and I did. My name is not Ashley. I know not what is in that paper, but it must tell of my brother, Gabriel, my sister, of all.
Oh, Senor, are they living or dead?
Answer me you must, for I am Grace Conroy. The secretary had refolded the paper. He opened it again, glanced over it, fixed his eyes upon Grace, and, pointing to a paragraph, handed it to the commander. The two men exchanged glances, the commander coughed, rose, and averted his face from the beseeching eyes of Grace. A sudden death-like chill ran through her limbs as, at a word from the commander, the secretary rose and placed the paper in her hands. Grace took it with trembling fingers. It seemed to be a proclamation in Spanish.
I cannot read it, she said, stamping her little foot with passionate vehemence.
Tell me what it says. At a sign from the commander, the secretary opened the paper and arose. The commander, with his face averted, looked through the open window. The light streaming through its deep, tunnel-like embrasure, fell upon the central figure of Grace, with her shapely head slightly bent forward, her lips apart, and her eager, passionate eyes fixed upon the commander. The secretary cleared his throat in a perfunctory manner, and, with the conscious pride of an irreproachable linguist, began.
Notice. To His Excellency the Comandante of the Presidio of San Felipe. I have the honor to report that the expedition sent out to relieve certain distressed emigrants in the fastnesses of the Sierra Nevadas, said expedition being sent on the information of Don Jose Bluent of San Geronimo, found in a canyon east of the Canada del Diablo the evidences of the recent existence of such emigrants buried in the snow, and the melancholy and deeply to be deplored record of their sufferings, abandonment, and death. A written record preserved by these miserable and most infelicitous ones gives the names and history of their organization, known as Captain Conroy's Party, a copy of which is annexed below. The remains of five of these unfortunates were recovered from the snow, but it was impossible to identify but two, who were buried with sacred and reverential rites. Our soldiers behaved with that gallantry, coolness, patriotism, inflexible hardihood, and high-principled devotion which ever animate the swelling heart of the Mexican warrior. Nor can too much praise be given to the voluntary efforts of one Don Arthur Poinsett, late lieutenant of the Army of the United States of America, who, though himself a voyager and a stranger, assisted our commander in the efforts of humanity. The wretched dead appeared to have expired from hunger, although one was evidently a victim. The tongue of the translator hesitated a moment, and then with an air of proud superiority to the difficulties of the English language, he resumed. A victim to fly poison. It is to be regretted that among the victims was the famous Dr. Paul de Verages, a natural, and collector of the stuffed bird and beast, a name most illustrious in science. The secretary paused, his voice dropped its pretentious pitch, he lifted his eyes from the paper, and fixing them on Grace, repeated, deliberately. The bodies who were identified were those of Paul de Verages and Grace Conroy.
Oh, no, no, said Grace, clasping her hands, wildly, it is a mistake.
You are trying to frighten me, a poor, helpless, friendless girl. You are punishing me, gentlemen, because you know I have done wrong, because you think I have lied.
Oh, have pity, gentlemen.
My God save me, Philip.
And with a loud, despairing cry, she rose to her feet, caught at the clustering tendrils of her hair, raised her little hands, palms upward, high in the air, and then sank perpendicularly, as if crushed and beaten flat, a pale and senseless heap upon the floor. The commander stooped over the prostrate girl.
Send Manuela here, he said quickly, waving aside the proffered aid of the secretary, with an impatient gesture quite unlike his usual gravity, as he lifted the unconscious Grace in his arms. An Indian waiting woman hurriedly appeared,
and assisted the commander to lay the fainting girl upon a couch. "Poor child," said the commander, as Manuela, bending over Grace, unloosed her garments with sympathetic feminine hands. "Poor little one, and without a father." "Poor woman," said Manuela to herself, half aloud, "and without a husband."